Morning, everybody. Welcome to our service this morning. We don't have anyone doing the announcements this morning, so, well, there's not much to announce, really. July and August are generally very quiet months, and things are fairly relaxed and fairly slack. To all those who are watching the service this morning at home, welcome. And we trust that you'll feel part of our worship. To those who are in caravans, and I know there are quite a lot, I can't really say much to you at the moment regarding the weather, but hopefully the warm weather will return and you'll have a nice relaxing break. I've been asked to announce that if you're able to help out, there are lots of vacancies on the flower rota. Isn't that right, Heather? The flower rota? Sorry? And the tea and coffee rota as well. So please, if you're available, put your name on the lists. You'll find them in the porch to my right. A number of our younger folk are away also, but there will be an opportunity for children to go out after the reading, and you'll get a nice video or something to occupy your time while us folks enjoy the sermon. And I think that's about it. Today, I thought we would think about creation and the importance of the way in which we look after creation. It is God's creation that we are enjoying. And that's going to be our theme for this morning. And it's based on a verse at the very beginning, or towards the beginning of the Word of God, the Scriptures. A verse found in Genesis chapter 8. And the 22nd verse simply says, "As long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease." That is God's promise to us. And so we're thinking about that promise in our worship this morning. And we're going to continue to worship God now as we sing our opening praise. And our worship today is involving hymns old and new. And this first hymn is one of the old hymns that we have in our hymn books. All things bright and beautiful. We thank God for all his wonderful gifts to us. And so let's all join together as we sing our opening hymn. Let's stand to sing. Now let's join together in prayer. What a rousing hymn, Lord, that is. And we thank you for the hymn writer Cecil Francis Alexander. Thank you that in these words we are reminded of just how amazing you are. Just how wonderful your creation is. And just how astonishing is the fact that you love us, from the youngest to the very oldest. Each of us is precious in your sight. Not one of us is forgotten or overlooked. You who made the heavens and the earth, you love us as individuals. And sometimes when we feel a little bit down, disheartened, when things are going badly for us, when we're encountering all sorts of strains and stresses, it's good for us to remind us that you are our God. You are our Creator. More than that, you are our friend. Each little flower that opens, each little bird that sings, you made their glowing colors. You made their tiny wings. Jesus said that not even a sparrow falls to the earth unseen by you. And if a sparrow is important to him, how much more important are we? You demonstrated your love for us and for all of humanity by sending your Son Jesus to be the Redeemer of this world. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. How often do we hear those words read? How often do we say them ourselves in our moments of quietness and reflection? Yet somehow or other, sometimes those words don't really sink home. You loved the world so much that you gave your only Son. You love us so much that you give us your only Son through your Holy Spirit. Help us to grasp that thought. Help us to hold on to that thought, especially in those tough times. We do freely acknowledge that we have let you down. We do let you down. It's part of our human frailty and weakness. We aren't the people that you want us to be. So, Lord, we thank you that forgiveness is available to us through Christ's sacrifice on the cross. Hands that flung stars into space to cruel nails surrendered. A hymn that we'll be singing earlier on has that as one of its lines. And what immortal words those are. Hands that flung stars into space to cruel nails surrendered. If nothing else, that line from the hymn should remind us of just what importance and value you have placed on us, on our lives. So, Lord, help us to experience afresh your love, and help us also to share that love with the people that we will meet this coming week. Who knows what opportunities we'll have of sharing our faith with others. Help us not to be shy. Help us not to hold back. But in a loving, in a quiet way, help us to share all that we have with someone who might not yet know your love in their lives. So, Lord, may our worship today be a fitting time of refreshment and preparation as we look forward to this new week. Bless all our families, our friends, who are on holidays at this time. May they be refreshed physically and emotionally because of their time of relaxation. So we commit all that we do and all that we say in these few moments together into your hands, and we ask your blessing upon us as we pray. And all our thoughts in our opening prayer are summed up in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. You might be thinking, have I missed something? Have I been asleep for the last couple of months? Because this will sound a little bit like a harvest service, but it's not a harvest service. Now, experts tell us that the Jewish tradition was to celebrate a number of harvests. For example, there was a special service where they brought the first fruits of the harvest at the beginning of the harvest to give thanks to God and also to ask his blessing upon the harvest. Linda here knows more about Jewish tradition than I, but that's something that I think is true. Then at the end, there was the feast which celebrated the harvest. So if you like, everything that the Jews did was to give thanks to God at the beginning and at the end of harvest time. So today we're thinking about God's creation, and what better reading could there be than Psalm 8 to reflect on the beauty of God's creation. Psalm 8, let's hear these words. And after the psalm, there's an opportunity to leave for children this morning. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him? You've made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Now, before you leave with the folks who want to leave for Sunday school, we were shopping the other day, and Edna's eye fell on this packet of seed. Now, it's a very small thing, so you won't be able to see it. I used this last week over in Broom Hedge, and I brought the packet around and even handed out some seeds to some of the folks, but I wouldn't have enough to pass around to all of you. Some of you might feel neglected, therefore, so I thought I'd better not do it. But if I take one seed out, you'll definitely not see that, no matter how good your eyesight is. But what I said to the folks in Broom Hedge last Sunday was, isn't it amazing that out of something so small, so tiny, something beautiful can emerge, something beautiful can grow. Now that is, of course, if you've got green fingers. My mom had green fingers. whatever the opposite of green fingers is, that's what I have. Seeds come to my garden to die. And that's not Australian for this day. They come to die. I'm not an expert in growing flowers. But anyway, for those who can, this seed will produce a wonderful flower for their garden. When God plants the seed of his love in our lives, something wonderful, something beautiful can grow, because he is the wonderful gardener. He is the one who makes things grow. Now, if it wasn't for his creative power, these seeds would certainly not grow in your garden, certainly not in mine, but even in your garden, if you're a good gardener. He is the one who makes things grow. He is the one who has the creative power to produce wonderful things from tiny little seeds. And if we allow the seed of his love to be planted in us, then something wonderful can grow in our lives and through our lives. Now, that's not the sermon, by the way. That's just an appetizer. So if you want to depart, now we'll set the age as something under 20 or 30 or 40. So if you want to go and have some time of fellowship together, please do so. Mentioned the line from one of our newer hymns, The Servant King, in the opening prayer, and we're going to sing that hymn now. It's one of my favourite hymns. It says so much about the love of God, and so we're going to sing the words of The Servant King. The words, hopefully, will be on the screen. Yes, there they are. From heaven you came, helpless babe, entered our world, your glory veiled, not to be served, but to serve, and give your life that we might live. This is our God, the Servant King. Let's stand to worship him.
Thank you.
At the beginning of the month, we went down to Wexford for a few days, just for a short break, to catch up with some of the family down there. A number of my nephews are involved in farming. Mostly, they are grain farmers. And so at that stage, they were preparing for the harvest. The winter barley was ripening nicely, and then would come the oilseed, rape, and all the other crops that are part and parcel of their summer routine. Our little grandson Eli had a great time in the shed where the combines and the tractors and the loaders are, trying all the various bits and pieces of equipment. It was a bit of a job getting him down from the combines, mind you. When he got up there, he, in his imagination, was cutting acres and acres of this, that, and the other thing. But anyway, all of this got me to thinking about the importance of God's creation. And one particular verse came to mind as I explored this theme. I've already used the verse as the opening act of worship this morning. As long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. That's God's promise to humanity. A week or two ago, you might have seen this picture on the news. Now, this is the James Webb Space Telescope. It's recently apparently taken over from the Hubble Space Telescope. And right at this moment, it's taking pictures of the universe. Now, this is no box brownie job. Do you remember those? If you're my age, you probably will. It's an amazing piece of kit. Apparently, it can do things, and with greater clarity than the Hubble telescope ever could. It's a very serious piece of kit. Now, don't ask me to explain what I'm about to say to you, because I typed it out, and even now I don't understand it, but apparently it's true, so take my word for it. It can take pictures of universes billions of miles away and billions of years into the history of the universe. Now you figure that one out, or go and speak to someone who knows a bit more than I do, and they'll try to explain it to you. But I imagine even they will find it difficult. The more we see of the universe, the more we try to understand its vastness and its magnificence, the more amazed we become at the creative power of the Almighty. Now, of course, some people would have us believe that all of that happened by chance. I look at things in a different way, and I'm sure, I hope you do as well. I believe that it takes more faith to believe that something like this can happen by chance than it does to believe in a creator who made it in the first place. Let me show you another picture. Now, this is a very famous painting by a painter called Constable. It's called the Hay Wain, and John Constable painted it. It's recognized as a beautiful piece of art, created by an amazing artist. Now let me show you this picture. Now this is a picture of a palette, an artist's palette, with paints and brushes, and all the paraphernalia that an artist would use. Now, Think about this for a moment. How long would you have to wait for all those bits and pieces to come together and produce a piece of art like that painting that we saw just a moment or two ago? Or ask another question. How long would it take you or me to use those pieces of equipment, the paints, the brushes, etc., etc.? How long would it take for us to take all of those things and create a piece of art similar to the one that we saw just a few moments ago? I would suggest that the answer to both questions is we'd be waiting a brave length of time. In fact, we'd be waiting forever. Only an artist with genius in her or his hands could take paints and brushes and produce a work of art similar to the one that John Constable produced, a piece of art like the Hay Wain. The first verse of the book of Genesis simply says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. When that beginning was, I have no notion. How it happened, I have no notion. But God's word says, in the beginning, I created the heavens and the earth. It's not on the script, so don't go looking for it. I'm speaking to our wonderful producer at the back who produces or portrays all these slides. That thought should really amaze us. To think that one so powerful is interested in us and is with us in our worship this morning. Whether it's here in church or watching on our laptop or our television screen through YouTube, it is amazing to think that one so mighty should be watching us who are so lowly and so insignificant in the world's scheme of things. We're back on script. The fifth slide asks the question, but simply emphasizes that we should be grateful for what the Almighty has done for us and is doing for us and will do for us. We should be eternally grateful. I'm sure every parent would say that it's a good thing to bring up children to say please and thank you, to show gratitude to those who do or perform acts of kindness. It's the right thing to do. I'll tell you about an incident that happened when I was a child, maybe 8 or 9 or thereabouts, so about 30 or 40 years ago or thereabouts. I'm part of a large family. I'm the youngest of 10. And there was an elderly gentleman used to come to Kelly, as we used to put it back in the old days, in our house on a regular basis, maybe once a month. And Dick would arrive at our house and he'd be welcomed. Us kids particularly welcomed him because he always came with a packet of biscuits. So this particular evening, Dick arrived and Mum and Dad welcomed him, and Mum was taking his coat or hat, or maybe it was Dad, can't remember, it's a long time ago. And he duly presented his packet of biscuits to one of my older sisters. Sadly, she's no longer with us. And she took the packet of biscuits and brought them into the kitchen where the rest of us were doing our homework, or whatever it was we were doing at the time. And in a very loud voice, this is what my sister said. Huh, would you look at the old things he's brought with him tonight? It was a packet of plain biscuits, Marietta, whereas some nights he would have brought custard creams or chucky biscuits or something. And back in the 1950s or 60s, it was a bit of a treat. Not so as far as my sister thought. Huh, would you look at the old things he brought with us tonight? I'm sure my mum and dad were mortified. That was not gratitude. Not gratitude. But how often do we show a similar attitude to the Almighty? When I look back, I'm often saddened or ashamed that I was not as grateful as I should have been to my parents for all the sacrifices that they made on my behalf and on behalf of my siblings. How grateful are we to God for all that he has given to us? That psalm, Psalm 8, is a mighty psalm. It's an amazing psalm. And it's already one that we are familiar with this morning. Let me remind you of just a couple of those verses. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars, which you have set in place, what is humanity that you are mindful of us? Verse 6 stresses the place that God has put us in this order of creation. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet. Verse 9 says, O Lord, our Lord. That little phrase, our Lord, is so important. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Gratitude to God for his wonderful gifts. Moving on, the next slide simply says we should be careful how we use those gifts. With privilege comes responsibility. Climate activists have long been trying to warn us about the dangers of global warming, but sadly, much of the world has been in denial. Now, of course, history tells us that climate is never static. It's always changing, always has done in the history of humanity, in the history of the world before humanity. Google is a wonderful instrument if you use it with the proverbial pinch of salt. But according to Google, the Ice Age began 2.4 million years ago and lasted until about 11,500 years ago. I wasn't around, so I can't dispute those figures, but that's what Google says. That's what the scholars tell us. It's almost certainly true, however, that human activity has contributed to many of the changes that we're seeing in our world, in our climate today. The pollution of the seas with plastic, for example. The gas guzzlers that the Americans talk about producing fumes, or the chimneys in China belching smoke. Some parts of Australia in the past have been recently battling with floods, whereas other parts of Australia have experienced long-term drought. Just a week or so ago, meteorologists were telling people in London, stay indoors, 40 degrees plus. As is always the case, of course, across the world, it's the poorest who suffer most. We must always remember that one day humanity will have to give an account of our stewardship of all God's wonderful resources. Then the third and the last point, and it's the last slide, the seventh slide for this morning, we should be concerned about the legacy that we leave for our children. I think I've only come to terms with that thought, I've only really begun to think about that since we added a third generation to our particular family with the coming of our grandchild. What sort of world are we passing on to our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, and their children, and so on? Sometimes we can feel very powerless when we think about such matters. I suppose one of the things we can do is lobby those who are in power so that they will not lose sight of this important issue. Then there are the relatively small but important things that we as individuals can do. I've still got a vested interest in farming. It's part of my DNA, as it were. And down in my part of the world, and I'm sure here as well, farming communities are taking much more care of the land. Hedgerows, which once would have been ripped out, are being left. Headlands are being left to provide for butterflies and for bees and all the rest of it, so that pollen can be found and the world can be a better place as a result. Small things, yet significant things nonetheless, so that we can leave a positive heritage for our children. And then there's a moral and spiritual legacy that we are leaving behind us. I'm sure you'll agree it's a sort of a dog-eat-dog society out there, where the rich get richer, the poor get poorer. In our Western society, the influence and standing of the church and religion has been in decline for years. And in some cases, that's perfectly understandable, given the scandals that there have been in recent times. So what sort of legacy, moral legacy, spiritual legacy, are we leaving behind? It's important that our children learn from us those wonderful values which we find in God's truth, God's word. I must really be getting old, because the things that really strike me now are the things I learned in Sunday school. I know Sunday school's broken up for the summer and kids are enjoying the holidays and all the rest of it, but we should thank God, we do thank God, for the things taught in Sunday school. The old hymns which I would have learned by heart. I forget where I put my keys about 3 or 4 times a day, but I can still recite some of those wonderful hymns which Mum and Dad, well, particularly Mum, used to try and teach me. Lessons learned, inculcated, absorbed years and years ago are still there because of godly men and women, Sunday school teachers, parents, friends, older sisters, my brother, the things that were learned from them. In early Jewish tradition, the faith was handed on from generation to generation, largely by word of mouth. That's why it's lasted for so long. What sort of legacy is this generation leaving for the next generation? It's a challenging thought, isn't it? And if sometimes again we feel a little bit powerless and think, well, what can I as an individual do to change all of this? Then let's just take it one little step, one tiny step at a time. One little act of kindness at a time. One little word or thought shared at a time. So that each little drop in the ocean will make a significant change in the life of someone who is near to us and dear to us. What sort of legacy are we leaving for our children? That verse with which we began this morning, and I'm finishing now, you'll be glad to hear, I'm finishing now. That verse contains both a warning and a promise. The warning comes at the very beginning. And it simply says this, as long as the earth remains. As long as the earth remains. Seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. The promise is in those last three words of the verse, will never cease. And so at the beginning of the harvest season, if we get a chance, not in a dogmatic way or a down your throat way, let's, as the people of God, share some of those thoughts with someone this coming week. Let's pray, and then we'll finish with our closing hymn. And we do remember our farming community as they begin the harvest season. Without them, where would we be? We recognize the importance of the harvest when we see what's happening in Ukraine and those millions of tons of grain that will simply lie there unless that terrible, unjust war comes to an end. As a result, millions of people will starve in Africa and Asia and elsewhere in the world. So we thank God for the work of our farming community. We thank God for the seasons, springtime and harvest. And we pray that God will prosper the work that takes place in our fields and in the fields of Ukraine in this coming month or two. We remember all our folks on holidays, those in caravans perhaps, or those who are taking a well-earned break or rest somewhere else, either here in Ireland or further afield. Lord, may that time of rest and relaxation be a time of preparation for another winter's work. We think of our children especially. No doubt they're enjoying a time of relaxation from school and from lessons and from homework. Lord, protect our young folk in this summer time. Keep them safe. Indeed, keep all our loved ones safe as they travel. Or whatever it is they are doing, may your protecting, loving hand rest upon them. And Lord, we know that COVID has not yet departed these shores. We are told that 1 in 17 have COVID in our community, in our province. And so for all who are still suffering the effects of COVID, particularly long COVID, we pray, Lord, your healing hand will rest upon them, and that soon they'll be restored to better health and strength. We give you thanks once again, as we've done many times, for the wonderful work that our doctors and nurses have done over these past months and years. Lord, thank you for them, and continue to use them as your instruments of healing. We pray for our individual homes and families. Each of us coming through the doors of the church today brought with us our own particular concerns. Whether it's the health of a loved one, whether it's a relationship problem, whether it is a financial issue, whatever it is, help us now to take this opportunity to simply commend all our thoughts, our concerns to you. And so in a quiet moment, we bring our own personal, private prayers, and we offer them in the name of Jesus, who died for us and who is present with us through his Holy Spirit, as we pray this morning. Lord, all that we have shared with you in private or openly, all that we now seek to be as we return to our daily responsibilities this coming week, all that we would want to be as we try to be your servants, sharing your faith, we offer now to you. And we do it in the name of Jesus Christ and for his sake. Amen. And our closing hymn this morning is, Lord of Creation, to you be all praise. Thank you. And as you go for your tea or coffee, just to remind you that there are still vacancies on the list and also on the flower rota. So please sign up after the service is over. We're going to give thanks to God for his gifts as we dedicate our offering, and then we'll share in the benediction. So let's, for one last moment, one last time, bow in prayer. Lord, may all that we offer to you today in our worship, in our praise, and in the giving of our gifts, may all be acceptable in your sight. Lord, bless the offerings that we have brought. Bless each giver, each home and family that we represent. And may your love, grace and mercy remain with us always. Let's bless each other as we share in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Amen.